Hello, good evening, everybody. We are so excited. Welcome to our spring lecture series. This is the second lecture of our series. We are completely honored and delighted to have Kenneth Frampton joining us this evening. I will pass off the mic to my colleague, Professor Michael Schwarting, who will introduce him, and we would like to have a warm round of applause for Michael.
Yes, good evening, and I don't think I've ever seen it quite this full, so this is wonderful. I'm very privileged to be able to do this introduction of Kenneth Frampton tonight. The paper that you got has a few short paragraphs, but Kenneth's resume would probably be a book in itself, and his resume is very packed, and it's not so easy to unpack it. So some highlights that I think are important to us, and I would say related to 40th Street and 116th Street on the west side, somewhere between the ends of the NYIT being in the middle. We had the well-known British invasion in the 60s. The Beatles, films, fashion, remember Twiggy, and yes, architects. A gang, including Kenneth, that brought lots of information and ideas that we were missing, and in somewhat primitive, maybe noble savage existence, awareness in the U.S. Although an architect before Kenneth arrived, he positioned himself as a teacher and a writer of design, important design and history, and as a critic, great English attributes. Many here tonight have been students of Kenneth's or worked as colleagues of Kenneth's, from Jonathan Friedman back in Princeton to Nader Vesugian at Columbia. And I thought maybe just maybe show of hands of how many people studied and worked with Kenneth, out of curiosity. Okay, it's considerable. So two things to highlight amongst so many. In the late 60s, down on 40th Street, Kenneth was behind Peter Eisenman's Institute for Architecture and Urban Studies, the IAUS, or what we used to call the TOOT. He co-founded the journal Oppositions, a very critical journal that had 26 issues from 1973 to 1984. Those are sort of prized a collection of very important documents. And all of this was very important, this period of time of the Institute, to creating a New York architectural culture and putting the city on a kind of important global map. In 1972, lured from Princeton, perhaps you wanted to leave Princeton, I'm not sure, Kenneth was asked by the new dean, James Polshek, to form a curriculum. Kenneth didn't write a mission or make a strategic plan, but he wrote a catalog. He fixed the courses, and he collected some important people to work together. This put Columbia on the map as a school, and I would say school with a kind of capital S, after nearly collapsing in the hiatus of the 60s. Although I said he was behind what happened at the Toot and at Columbia, it would be more appropriate, and I think Kenneth would be happier, if I said he was in front or led as a kind of avant-garde position in these places. This has resulted in two critical contributions that should also be highlighted. One, a kind of forever pursuing the relationship between form and tectonics, a word that Kenneth has brought us to use over and over again. I keep thinking it could be a sort of British architectural drink, gin and tectonics. But it's, I think, an issue that we struggle with to get it right still in our pedagogies. And also the second thing, that he brought politics, the discussion of ideology, into the discourse of architecture. For a time, we in fact loved the Russians, at least the suprematists and the constructivists and even the Marxists. This was quite absent in the U.S., and we only have to think of Philip Johnson's international style to see where we've come from. I believe he shares an important kinship with Jürgen Habermas's belief in the modernist project, which Kenneth brought to architecture and to us even before Habermas. All of us admire him for who he is and for what he has given to us. And so I'd like to welcome Kenneth to our school.
Thank you. Thank you all for coming. I've said once or twice this evening already that I think it's a very nice sort of, it's hard to talk about these things, but I just think it's a very nice spirit in this place, and compounded, I'm sure, of many somewhat intangible things. And I've been here before, of course, but I've never been in this lecture hall, so pretty astonished by this, the comfort and the intimacy of this space. Am I talking? Is it all right? Can you hear me? I hope. And and I realize I don't have that much time. I mean, I'm told I should carry on for about an hour, and then my colleague Nada Vasuhian will engage with me for a while, and I think administer the right amount of suspicion, etc., as to what I've been trying to pursue in the time I have at my disposal. And of course, you already know this is the cover of the book, which some of you have been kind enough to purchase, and which I must say, I didn't realize it was $25, because I think it's actually a relatively inexpensive book, as a matter of fact, by today's standards, which astonishes me, because actually last night my colleague Mary McLeod was complaining about the price of architectural books. So this is the cover of this thing. Actually, it's very funny. I was very involved in the design. It's Lars Müller, of course, and Lars got very impatient with me in particular, because of course we were late, delinquent. And we had a kind of disagreement about the cover. Well, I had a more elaborate cover. I think he has the right cover. Anyway, it's as good as any other. I'm not entirely sure about the color, but what can I say? Anyway, why don't I get down to the topic and stop digressing about graphics. And, this brings me to Lars again, of course, because he said, I'll try and keep it as simple as possible. I mean, in fact, I think Michael might have experienced this, but in any case, I came to the States first in 65. I started to teach in Princeton, which was a very prosperous place, not quite as prosperous as it is now. But it had a rather new school of architecture, and it had a new dean soon after I arrived, Robert Geddes from Philadelphia. And it had these young Turks, and I should also say, because one of these young Turks that's not so young anymore will be the last lecturer in this lecture series in the school, which of course is the illustrious Peter Eisenman, without whom, there would have been no Institute for Architecture and Urban Studies, without a doubt, without his charismatic genius for what he called souffle making. I think it wouldn't have happened, and I'm sure it wouldn't have happened, and everything that happened in that place was very much to do with his, it's a kind of genius, really. And so it's a touching fact that here I am, the second lecturer, and he is the last. But anyway, he is responsible for inviting me to Princeton in the first place, and it kind of changed changed the trajectory of my life, I think, because I hadn't had the idea that, I was trained as an architect. I was coming to the States on a visit. I didn't have any idea that I would end up staying here, basically. And with all the privileges that were sort of, what can I say, made available to me, particularly in Princeton, it's another period of history altogether, because that place then was rather naive and very generous, and of course it was maybe a particular generous moment in the history of the United States as well. Anyway, at some point I became a member of the faculty there, and I had the naivete, talking about naive places and naive people, to accept to teach a course which had the title Values, Concepts, and Methods. This was a course invented by Bernard Spring, who had come from MIT and who was the right hand of Robert Geddes' dean, was in fact associate dean. And so, you know, somehow or other, I agreed to give this course. And I gave it for a semester, and then I realized, you know, I was all out of, what can we say, you know, quality reading for architectural students. And for myself, in fact, you know, not that, I mean, it's my own limitations. And so I had one more semester to go with this crazy title, Values, Concepts, and Methods, and I decided to ask the students to analyze buildings, existing buildings. Well, really projects also. And then I realized something, which is that, you know, in a way, if you analyze a single thing, you learn more and more about it, but it is its own, it confirms itself in a way. There's no dynamic, you know, I think, built into the procedure. And then I thought, well, if you compare two works answering the same programmatic brief, then coming from different ideological standpoints, then the question of what is similar and what is different would be highlighted by comparing them under certain categories. So that's the beginning of this whole thing. And I think I've digressed already, because I was going to explain this title, A Genealogy of Modern Architecture, because the course I gave, which starts then probably, I don't really know exactly the first time, to tell you the truth, but somewhere around 69, I think, I started to give this course, and I would give it in Princeton, but then later in Columbia, and also later in the Royal College of Art in London. And it, you know, became my party trick, basically. And the title of it was Comparative Critical Analysis of Built Form. And Lars said, well, you can never sell a book with a title like that. So he came up with this idea of A Genealogy of Modern Architecture. And I quite like that title. But then it trapped me in trying to justify the title. And there's a lot of blurb at the beginning of this book, which is really an attempt to justify the title. And part of the blurb in part one is to the synoptic history of the modern movement. And there the dates are quite important. It's 23 to 1980. And actually, well, 23 because basically the one of the key buildings that always started the course, which was the Rietveld Schroeder House in Utrecht, is more or less finished by 1923. 1923 is also the year of the Van Doesburg Van Eesteren exhibition of neoplastic architecture in Paris. Two things sort of coincide. And 1980 is actually the year that I published the book Modern Architecture Critical History, which it always surprises me is also the year of the first Biennale in Venice, curated by Paolo Portoghese, with the slogan, the end of prohibition and the presence of the past, which really opens to a kind of postmodern style in a big way. And so the date 1980 is also the 1 year after the English translation of Jean-François Louis Lyotard's The Postmodern Condition. And I think that, you know, compared to the modern project as it was between the end of the First World War and the beginning of the Second World War. After the war, the modern project was by no means the same, for obvious reasons. Above all, of course, Auschwitz on the one hand and Hiroshima on the other, Hiroshima and Nagasaki. I mean, with these two things, particularly the nuclear, use of nuclear weapons in this fashion, You know, the idea of progress in the 19th century sense was no longer, could no longer be believed in the same way. And I think that's what is the huge difference between the modern project before the Second World War and the modern project after the Second World War. And so, I think there is, of course, there is a reconstruction of Europe after the Second World War, et cetera, but the philosophical argument that there is no more grand narratives, which is basically the argument of Lyotard in the postmodern condition, is kind of, you know, in a sort of philosophical sense, sort of decisive. And I think apart from the question of postmodern style, I think this condition of a kind of post-condition is unavoidable. But, and the but is that I still have this kind of scar left on the mind that the modern project, in the Habermas sense, the unfinished modern project, is still an aspiration, and that the legacy of the heroic modern movement between the end of the First World War and the beginning of the Second is still an extremely rich legacy that is part of our tradition. And then I would say the tradition of the new, you know. And I'm someone who is sort of more or less convinced after Zygmunt Bauman that, you know, the relationship between innovation and tradition is, symbiotically unavoidable, and that you can't really have a tradition that can be considered a living tradition without innovation, and you can't really have innovation without a vital tradition. In cultural terms, anyway, of course, it doesn't. Well, it's a whole other issue for the dominant ethos of technoscience. But anyway, obviously, it's a long conversation which can't possibly be dealt with in the space of an hour, let alone. Anyway, and so I indulge in this whole, like, these two artistic emblems, one of which is on the cover of the book, and the other one is this a schema of a purist painting by Le Corbusier circa 1920, this mariage de contour, which you see in the image, this image, of course, as opposed to that, that these two things are lying there behind the legacy of the modern movement and the tradition. And actually this extraordinary map, which I will show again, which he being Le Corbusier, publishes in 1925, which is a map of Europe where it's coded in three code letters. One is I, which stands for industry, one is F, which stands for folklore, and one is C, that stands for culture, but I've always interpreted it to mean culture in the sense of classic, although he does not say that. It has the word, simply the word culture. And in different parts of Europe, you know, there are different densities of the I, C, and F, you know, as which is his retrospective view of what was the state of affairs in Europe in 1912 when he took his famous voyage d'Orient, of which there is a map. Okay, and if we jump now, because I have no choice in the space of an hour, but to jump to 1927 and to this famous axo of Le Corbusier's competition entry for the Société des Nations, this amazing axonometric, and then the fact that it is very different from this axonometric, although it's, of course, Hans Meyer, Hans Pitper entry for the same competition. And this second image, and there are other images that are a little different, but what's, of course, very striking is the fact that Meyer and Pitper do not show the landscape at all, and the, and Le Corbusier, why isn't it going, oh, there we are, okay. Does, of course. The building is, you know, inextricably layered into the landscape. And in the Meyer case, there is no landscape. And there's no axo by Meyer-Pitper where the landscape is shown, in fact. And And so, you know, I didn't know anything about this until, and I now forget the date, Claude Schneid, Swiss, German architect, who publishes a book, Hannes Meyer, Buildings, Projects, Writings. I think it must be, I don't know, 86, 87. Anyway, you know, that gives me the material of the other, well, there's one other interesting entry by Neutter and Schindler, but you know, if you compare these two, anyway, for me, you know, in 88, I write this thing, Humanist versus Utilitarian Ideal, that's what it was called, appeared in magazine AD, and in a way, it's like crystallizes for me. I mean, I've been, and that's what's odd, you know, I can't really figure it all out, that I'd been doing this analysis thing before, but somehow, anyway, these two entries for this competition kind of heighten the interest in comparing the solutions to different projects for to answer the same program. And you know, you can, of course, you can go on and on about this comparison, but maybe the most telling thing, I think, is that that this is all modular, you know? Sorry, I need, right, this. I mean, no, one more. You know, it's all quite obviously modular. The whole damn thing is on the same module. And moreover, this module could be added to and taken away from. In fact, you know, in essence, it's the system of the Crystal Palace of 1851, you know. I mean, he's not copying the Crystal Palace, but it is that idea of a repeated productive module that can, from which everything can be made. And, well, I can't get into this, but this is also changes in his career that, but let me go back just a minute to, because I obviously didn't quite finish this issue. Is that if you, and it's too boring to go into, but if you compare this auditorium to this auditorium, and if you think, well, you not only think, I mean, it's interesting because Le Corbusier calls it Palais des Nations, Palace of the Nations, and Meyer insists building for the League of Nations, you know. Meyer insists on the word building and not on, and repudiates the idea of architecture, basically. And, you know, ultra-materialist position. But when you compare the two auditoria, the more rational of the two auditoria, from the point of view of the coherence of the structure and the acoustics, is probably the Corbusier auditoria and not the Hannes Meyer. And I can't fully demonstrate that, but you can imagine that the angled girders that support this egg, you know, totally collide with the orthogonal gridded structure that surrounds it, amongst other irrationalities. And you can see from the drawing, and I don't have the drawing here, you know, that is so obviously a unresolved condition. So there's a paradox that when you compare those two buildings, that what is ostensibly ideologically materialist, industrialized, prefabricated, modular, it has in it, and that's not the only, you know, certain kind of incoherence because of the obsession of production and serialized production. You know, I mean, of course, it doesn't necessarily follow, but in this particular case, that's the strange contrast between them. And so then the next thing I have to sort of warn you about is the whole idea of type as a point of departure was very prevalent in the 60s, partly coming through Italian thing. And type in this sense, you know, in the sense of this is from Durand, it's a hypothetical rationalized type. Also, by the way, you can see there's a predilection in that type for modularity. And so one of the things under which, you know, I asked the students to look at two buildings, compare them as types, and type in relation to the context in which the building is situated. And here, you know, there's some more reflections on type, such as this 1948 Rudolf Virchow's Architectural Principles in the Age of Humanism, where the idea of type is not the only moment, but the idea of type in the Cattermole de Conci 1970 sense of type is returned to by this German historian, and I'm opposing it here to, you know, a continuity of type in the sense of biological type as it appears in Darcy Thompson's Growth and Form, you know, comparing somehow organic type and architectural type. And then this issue arises, public, semi-public, private, and service, because, then I have no choice but to enter into a book from which I will never recover, which is Hannah Arendt's book, The Human Condition of 58, that in which she coins the term, well, she, first of all, there are so many things in that book, but one thing is her distinction between work and labor, work as that state of affairs in which that which is produced is not intended for consumption. And labor as that state of affairs, the opposite, in fact, where the thing produced is intended for consumption. And where the work is to do with stasis and durability of the artificial world made by human species, and the other being fungible, never finished in a sense. And actually in another essay, and I don't want to get into it now, I make this distinction between architecture and building, where architecture is surely a noun and building is a gerund, you know, which is a verb noun, and implies already process in the word itself as opposed to architecture. You know. But anyway, she really, I just think that that book contains insights which I, you know, speaking for myself, I will never kind of ever get over. And one of the terms she uses, which is this term space of public appearance, which could be said of this space, for example, for sure, you know, is this honorific space where the body politic, the society gathers, you know, and therefore this distinction between public and private. I mean, this idea that the private, of course, is about intimacy and the public is about, collective being. So those two opposites I engaged with. And then, of course, this impossible, in between semi-public, and then finally the fourth category, service. I mean, which I told students, and I kind of believe it, I suppose, that are those spaces in a building which are spaces that, you know, basically you will not either enter or remain in for a very long time. So, I mean, one kind of classic, not classic, but one example which might clarify this is, you know, the average bathroom as hygiene box is something one enters and usually doesn't hang around, and that's it. It's a functional space of rather minimum dimensions designed for that purpose, and as opposed to, let's say, in a rather rich house in California, a room which has a jacuzzi and is opens to an outside terrace, then it becomes more problematic. I mean, what kind of that's also could be called loosely the bathroom, but obviously it isn't a service space in the same sense as the average minimum bathroom. And then there follows a whole, you know, storage, of course, escape stairs, elevator shafts, et cetera, are private. And so that's the way the whole game is set up. And then there is this business of the passage through the spatial sequence and this idea of root and goal, you know. And of course, here's the Villa Savoir, and I suppose it personifies the Le Corbusier notion of a promenade architecturale, you know, the idea of the root, goal, condition. Actually, I just read, I recently encountered a book which actually is written by an Iranian living in Berlin, and on phenomenology, actually. I think it's called an articulated phenomenological interpretation of architecture. It's an extraordinary work, and but in that work, he takes me to task for not really adequately pursuing, you know, the movement of the body being through the space. But I don't really think that this proves that I, doesn't prove the issue one way or another, but, you know, it's part of this story. And then, well, yes, maybe I have to go back, right. So, I don't quite know what I've done with it. Where is it? Oh, yes. It's this thing, structure membrane. Because the other thing I think is that, you know, the question of the structure and the question of whether it's expressed or suppressed, or the degrees to which it is expressed, suppressed, or both, you know, is an interesting, an interesting kind of aspect of the whole thing. And then, too fast. And then this question of details, and that's why I try to make the argument, you know, that the details connote values which are latent or even overtly present in the work, or the two works being compared in a different way. And so that's the categories, you know. And yes, so. And so I always began the course with these same two buildings, which is the Rietveld-Schroeder House, 23-24, of designed and built by a cabinet maker, Gerrit Rietveld, in Utrecht. It's still there, of course. It's a classic piece, been restored. It's a museum house, of course, by now. And it embodies this kind of neoplastic pinwheel idea, very much influenced by Dutch neoplastic painting, above all by Mondrian, of course, who publishes in 1917 Neoplasticism in Painting, and has an enormous influence on others, including Bart van der Lek and Thieu van Doesburg, and the De Stijl movement, otherwise neoplastic movement, is started as the war is ending, as the First World War is ending in 1918. And the manifesto that they publish sets up this opposition between the individual and the universal. And the aesthetic that is developed by Mondrian and also by Rietveld is, and by van Doesburg, van Eastren, when one tries to turn the aesthetic into the built, into a three-dimensional architectural work, and set against this work, which is the 1926 Maison Cook, Le Corbusier Pierre Generet in Bois d'Boulogne in Paris. And what's fascinating is that the two works also have manifestos that accompany them, so that the Rietveld house, and I don't think Rietveld in, you know, sort of, yeah, I don't know how consciously this was all processed by Rietveld. But in any case, van Doesburg, who's the kind of talking head painter, you know, leader of the movement, publishes this 16 points of a plastic architecture. And Le Corbusier publishes his 5 points of a new architecture in 1926. They are, you know, pilotis, free plan, free facade, fenêtre en longueur, and roof garden. You know, they, and, well, I can't go through all these more elaborate 16 points of van Doesburg, but I mean, the difference, I think, between the two works is very patent in that, well, and also historically, certain things are like, this is before, 1 year before the Maison Cook is 1 year before the Le Corbusier project for the Palais des Nations in Geneva. And the long window, which is one of the points, sorry, this thing, which, what do I have? Free facade, free plan, pilotis, fenêtre en longueur, roof garden. Actually, he had at some point when he first published it, a sixth point. And the sixth point was elimination of the cornice. And then he dropped it because, of course, he wanted to set up the 6 points as though they were a kind of quasi-scientific declaration of a new architecture. And if he had kept him, you know, the elimination of the cornice was a giveaway, because it's a giveaway in the sense that there's a sort of latent classicism here somewhere or other, and we better keep that quiet. So he cuts out the 6 point and publishes only 5. And so these are, you know, two works that are ostensibly answering the same program, which is the design of a middle-class house. And so, you see, this Rietveld Schroeder house isn't quite pure, because it ought to have been a kind of centrifugal work, but it's stuck on the end of a pre-existing brick terrace, so it has 3 sides which are actively pinwheeling, but the fourth is kind of buried, as you can see, and it looked out, and so one's comparing site plan for site plan here, you know. He looked out over what was once open countryside and will be eclipsed by an auto route quite early on. And whereas this one is wedged in a terrace, there's an automobile axis, which there is not in the Rietveld Schroeder house. There's a garage in there, built for American couple, by the way. Different class, really, because the Rietveld Schroeder house was built for an eccentric, progressive Dutch woman who was into, well, all sorts of progressive ideals, and in fact was a lover of Rietveld. Rietveld sets himself up in the house. He has even a little studio in the house. Whereas this is built for a relatively straight middle-class expatriate Americans, you know, who have, I think it's the... The wife is a painter, I think. And so they have, anyway, they end up with this house with its pilotis, you know, reinforced concrete frame construction, unlike the other one, which is a, you'd never know it, but, you know, it's all timber frame, and all this kind of plaster over stuff is kind of fake, you know, abstract bits and pieces. I mean, it's an extraordinary technical game in as much as these very large windows designed by the master cabinet maker swing out, you know, and blow open the corner of the building. And of course, none of that happens with the fenêtre en longueur, which Le Corbusier describes as a typical mechanical element of the house. So what the game is to, you know, it's kind of pathetic, but the game is by inspection to decide what is public, you know, it's kind of, you could say, totally banal. What is public, what is private, what is semi-public, what is service. By inspection, the plans are coded with these colors for what is, you know, public, private, semi-public, service. And then there are these two routes, the pedestrian route and the vehicular route, that more or less consistently are. So here you see, you know, the movement of the subject through the space. And in this case, there's a living dining kitchen on the ground floor. And these are sort of slim, quasi-private sleeping spaces. And when you go upstairs, you know, up this spiral staircase, then in the same corner as this one, you find the next living room, and then you know, again, ambiguous private spaces that are partly studios and partly sleeping spaces, and this extraordinary bathroom, which also collapses, so that when the thing is opened out and all the sliding elements move back, sliding, folding. And in this case, you know, the bathroom is folded up, then this becomes a kind of public space, you know, a very ample public space. So there is also this transformability, which I think was one of van Doesburg's 5 points. I mean, the fact that this is timber construction is evident, you see, from these floors, and as opposed to this one, where, you know, the Piloti, you know, there's only one showing between the cross walls, but nonetheless, it's there. And the garage is there, shown gray service. This is very ambiguous space. He marks it abri on the plan, which means shelter, but, you know, it was always left very ambiguous in this early moment, you know, raising the houses off the ground as part of the five-point deal, but not entirely clear what to do with the space underneath. And moreover, other kind of quaint things, like, for example, you go down this picturesque path and you enter into this entrance hall and you climb the staircase. But if you are a servant, you carry on around here and go up this little door because there's a separate servant entrance. You know, it's all a little weird to do with middle class, you could say, bourgeois values, including the fact that this is a boudoir of the madame, and then the master bedroom, and two other bedrooms. And a bathroom in the corner that serves all these bedrooms, you can enter from both sides. So that's gray, the whole thing, plus this storage. And the staircase is treated as a kind of public space, although it's, of course, very minimal. I mean, you can imagine the kind of contradictions that are sort of unavoidable. But when you come up, then the whole of this L, which is dining, living, dining, and here is the kitchen, which can also be accessed, built on top of the bathroom. And then this is a double height space. This is the void over the double height space. And this staircase goes up to this library, which opens out to the terrace. So the L here, you know, is answered by the inverted L on the other side, and the double height volume links the elevated terrace at library level and the, how am I doing? Not very well, I think, but anyway. And so the idea then of the volume is very different. And this is actually a sort of retrospective color perspective by Riefeldt of what was the original scheme, which included painting the wooden floorboards different neoplastic colors, etc. And this doesn't have that kind of color. It does use color, but it doesn't use that kind of color. So you already have. And then this space here, which is a double height space. And oh yeah, okay. And this date also that's also very fascinating because he's influenced by Adolf Loos basically at this date. In fact, the magazine Le Spinovo published in 1920, Adolf Loos's Ornament and Crime, retranslation, because it had already been translated into French. And it's clear that the degree zero of the white architecture of the 5 points is like equally kind of degree zero as Loos's, you know, like the Steiner Villa of Loos, you know. So that they have in common. And the other is the paradoxical anti-total work of art attitude of Loos. I mean, from that point of view, the whole neoplastic project is to create another kind of total work of art where everything is pinwheeling about everything. Whereas in this work, there is a kind of break between above all, of course, it's got to do with the furniture and the carpets, because this is, you know, furniture and carpets bought by the clients. And this is what Loos's ethical argument is, that architects have the right to design built-in furniture, but as far as all movables, I mean, here he distinguishes between, in French, meuble, furniture, and immeuble, apartments, movables and immovables. you know, and he distinguishes at a kind of ontological level between, you know, furniture that can be bought to, by the clients according to their taste, not designed by the architect, thereby breaking the kind of oppressive magic of a total work of art, you know. And this is what you find in this work. And yet, at the same time, there is there's an assertion of the mechanical, you know, so that the radiators are exposed, and the, of course, the, it's of the same genre as the fenêtre en longueur, and the mechanical elements of the house. Whereas this game, where you have these slots of space and this round, you know, element that's on the axis of the double height space, is, you know, inherently has a kind of vestigial classical aspect. And so the although the 5 points set themselves up as you know, a kind of quasi-technical prescription, there is loaded into the 5 points ideological preferences. And among these preferences, of course, goes the double height space, which has two typological origins. One is the use of double height space in arts and crafts houses, you know, particularly in England, often operating together with the stair hall and the minstrel's gallery. And there's something, I think, there's a trace of that in this relationship of this, you know, gallery overlooking the double height space. And the other thing is the artist studio as double height space. So these two things are lying there in the, so, and then there is, of course, this categoric opposition between the corner casement windows and the sliding and actually small casements of the fenêtre en longueur. And then, of course, the terrace in the, the roof garden in the case of the Maison Cook, the pathos of this space and the, you know, kind of totally crazy servant's entrance at the back, you know? I mean, crazy by, I don't know, crazy by today's standards, could we say, you know? And then, you know, the analysis gets into, you know, what are the load-bearing walls in the case of this timber-framed, you know, framed-up load-bearing walls in case of this timber-framed Rietveld Schroeder house, versus the fact that these are two massive cross walls, and then there is this wall which coincides with the freestanding column. The span is going across that, of course, and then, as part of the whole business of expression suppression, the here there's also suppression in that, you know, that this is not the Maison Cook, but it's the same technology. Reinforced concrete frame construction, concrete block infill rendered over. This is the Villa Garsch of 1927, and this is the fundamental game, of course, even reinforcing, putting the reinforcement inside hollow concrete block. And that this little diagram is a diagram of the 5 points, really. The pilotis, the free facade, the free plan, well, you can't show it very well here, the fenêtre en longueur, and the roof garden, which is seen by him as compensating for having covered over the ground with the house in the first place. And then what is fascinating is that these colors, of course, this is actually a counter-composition made around 1924 by van Doesburg van Eastren, where you know, the technology is still the hypothetical technology of the framed house as in the Rietveld Schroeder house. But these, but the game is, of course, to through the use of the colored planes, suggest a kind of proliferation of planes, where you look closely, you know, there are pierced windows, but in fact, like here, for example, but in fact, this planar articulation suggests, you know, a pinwheeling of planes. And the colors then are part of that pinwheeling game. Whereas here, you know, the colors are being used in a more painterly fashion to make planes recede or advance, you know, spatially. The red ochre advancing somewhat, the blue, the sky blue receding somewhat, and that brings me, you know, full circle back to this map and this tension between references to folklore and to industry and to the classic, so that when you go back here, I'm looking for this image, you see this image, then the folklore is in this kilim on the floor, industry is the radiator and the fenêtre en longueur, and culture, quote unquote, classic, is in the architecture itself, you know. And so in terms of values, you know, this question of trying to reconcile conflicting values is, you know, inherent in the 1925 map of the 1925 Voyage d'Orient, and is present, of course, in the exposed radiators, the sliding casement windows in steel, even bent wood to some extent, typewriter, of course. And this, again, you know, this is actually Loos's, one of Loos's villas, you know, that is, you know, referred to. And this, of course, is a Mondrian painting and the red-blue chair of Rietveld, you know, showing these antecedents, therefore trying to argue that the connotations of the way the two houses are detailed allude to totally different value systems, so that this 1920 famous painting by Le Corbusier, still life with a pile of plates, you know, this being the pile of plates, but then guitar, of course, and then this ambiguous form, which is either a book or an architectural profile, and this bottle and the clay pipes and so on, and bottles. I mean, it's taking actually the café terrasse environment of the cubist and kind of rationalizing the cubist representation of this café terrasse. Café terrasse building, having in itself, you know, the value of urban bohemian life and therefore of a kind of urban bohemian culture. But one of the fascinating things about the aux enfants Le Corbusier creation of purist aesthetic, which comes with their 1918 first purist exhibition in Paris, and then their manifesto Après le Cubisme, and the 1920 manifesto Le Purisme. I mean, what is contained in both is that it is, of course, about painting and some kind of normative, iconic aesthetic of painting, because it's clear that it's meant to be an icon, you know. And as you know, the Mondrian, all of Mondrian's canvases are meant to be icons also. And and you see, this is actually a study by Bernard Hoseley of the implicit layering of the space inside this painting, and by the same figure, the implicit layering of the space inside the Villa Garche. And here, you know, from the 1925 essay from Exposition des Arts Décoratifs, where, you know, the standard object, the industrially produced standard object, like industrially produced glassware, standard musical instruments, clay pipes still then, and bottles and glasses and so on, you know, produced by industry, not really art objects, but objet, in a sense, objet trouvé, found objects, you know, found as the kind of spontaneous production of an industrial civilization. You know? And that is what is the value implicit in this work, I think, and that brings me what? To the end of the whole damn thing. And now they've vanished, so I can just indulge for a few more minutes. You know, here's the comparison of Aalto's 1937 pavilion to Le Corbusier's Pavillon de Temple Nouveau, or, I'm not going to go into it all, because it's just, it's altogether too much, right? But and then, of course, the Tugendhat House versus the Villa Maria. The Tugendhat is 1930, the Villa Maria is 39. And the book goes on like that. I've been talking more than an hour, I think. So in order not to drive everybody nuts, I think we should have a discussion. All right, thanks. Are we going to sit here? What's happening exactly? Right. Yes, go on. I feel like sitting down, actually, after that.
Thanks very much, Ken.
Okay. Right.
It's a special honor to be able to share this stage with you. Ken was my doctoral advisor, and I think as my colleague, Michael Schwarting, noted before, for those of you who don't know, Kenneth Frampton has been a teacher and a mentor to multiple generations of faculty and students in this room, so it's a real honor to have you here, and a pleasure too, and thank you very much for the presentation. This is a fantastic book, and it's a very useful book for me working with my students, particularly my beginning students, because it's a book that furnishes them with a set of concepts and categories that they can use in analyzing buildings on a comparative basis. And it does so in an accessible way. The categories that you use include type and context. The second one.
Well, the public-private.
Public-private service.
Semi-public.
Semi-public.
Yeah.
Incredibly useful. But then when, we discussed it in class and we also, when you applied it, I'm sure you also struggled with the limits of these terms at the same time. For example, when you talk about service spaces, in one place in passing, you mention a kitchen as an example of a service space, and yet I was very happy to see that in your treatment of the Schroeder House in Utrecht, that actually the kitchen is classified there as a public space.
Right. Yes.
So could you maybe talk about your own struggles in terms of using these terms and both their usefulness and their limitations?
Yeah. Right. It also has a very interesting historical sort of underpinning to all of that, because there's a great book by Barbara Miller Lane on German architecture. I forget German architecture in the interwar period mainly. And she points out something that the German term Wohnküche, which is like, obviously living kitchen, right? And she also points out that that was the peasant norm. The living kitchen was part of peasant houses, And then, you have, and actually, by the way, it's really worth reading again, Gideon's Mechanization Takes Command, which has in it a section where he traces, the evolution of the ergonomic kitchen, from Catherine Beecher Stowe, the labor-saving kitchen, in fact, up to the present, in a way. And it's fascinating that, actually I was just writing about her indirectly, that the Austrian committed socialist architect, Greta Schuter-Lehotsky, who would work after 1925 with Ernst Mai in Frankfurt for 5 years, you know, between 25 and 30, when Ernst Mai would go to the Soviet Union because the climate in Germany was already going towards the right, I suppose. And she went, she followed him to the Soviet Union. And she worked on the most, you know, her name is attached to the so-called Frankfurter Kuche, which is this ergonomic kitchen like a laboratory, you know, very, very, very organized but very narrow space that is in fact cut off from the living volume of the lower, of the low-cost housing. In most instances, the low-cost housing that Mai produced in Frankfurt in that five-year period, a very large amount, in fact, you know, she worked on that housing also, not just on the kitchen, but the kitchen is always like that. It's always this kitchen. And there, you know, you have historically the whole issue in a way, you know, of the... Yeah, and it's very interesting that it's American, the idea of the labor-saving kitchen. Of course, by now, you know, we, you know, the whole thing has evolved. So there are labor-saving kitchens which are also living kitchens, so that, you know, the tension between these two things doesn't arise anymore. But... you know, you can see how the point you've just raised also has its kind of historical, you know, ideological underpinning.
Mm.
Yeah. When is a kitchen service and when is it not?
You know, yeah, because I think, I mean, my impression is that, I mean, at least in the United States, that the kitchen tends to be a preeminent social space. I mean, it's where people like to hang out nowadays,
right,
it seems.
Yes, yes.
But
you know, its plan form is not then the super, you know, because the ergonomic kitchen is like, you know, it's conceived at some extreme point as though it is like working out a time motion study for somebody on a lathe in a factory,
mm-hmm.
that is treated, the operation is treated with it in the same way, mm-hmm. you know. And the woman, since one always assumes it is the woman in this case, is isolated from the family in that ergonomic space in this housing.
Mm-hmm.
Now I think all of that's passed. I think you could say sort of.
Mm-hmm.
You know, why I use the word sort of is that, you know, you never know quite. Well, we don't build housing anymore anyway, so in that sense, not really.
Mm-hmm.
So we haven't seen, you know, what we would produce under different conditions. You know.
Mm-hmm. I have one other question, and then I want to open it up for discussion. And it's actually a follow-up to a question that was raised about a year ago at the Center for Architecture when you first launched this book. Someone asked the question: have you been to all the houses? Yeah. That you actually discuss in the book, and you offered an answer that astounded me. You said that you actually haven't seen all the houses, and sometimes that's actually an advantage.
Yes.
Do you remember? Could you elaborate?
Yeah, right. Thank you. Well, I mean, well, it's a moot point whether it's an advantage or not. It's a bit stupid, isn't it? But
I should say dwellings, because it's not just houses you talk about in the book, of course.
No, it isn't. No, but I have been to quite a lot of them. I mean, I haven't been to all of them. That's the fact, you know. Like these, both the Villa Maria and the Tugendhat House. You know, I've been to that, and I've been to quite a lot.
But you say it's sometimes an advantage not to.
Right.
What does not that mean? To see the building.
What the hell does that mean?
In real life. What does that mean? And yeah. And what do you...
Yes, I know.
It seems counterintuitive.
It seems a
do
bit...
Do you still stand by that?
No, I think it's a bit provocative, isn't it?
Yeah.
I think. I mean, it's not... It's not really... It doesn't make too much sense.
But
no,
it,
I mean, the only
that,
thing about it is that since you're, you know, since you're using plans and, you know, drawings and other data, you know, you can get at what intrinsically the thing is, you know. It's quite different from actually directly experiencing it, of course, you know. That's obvious. But you know, if you're just playing a game with photographs, it's useless. But if you have, you know, drawings, reliable drawings, and other data about the two works, so you know, you can sort of get at it, you know. But I agree, it's absurd to say it's an advantage. It's absurd. Provocation.
Well, I mean, it's
provocation. Yeah. What else? I mean,
we'd love to hear some questions from you all. Yes.
So I'm just wondering if you could talk a little bit about why these buildings look as if, to the people at the time, they just fell out of the sky, that they landed, right? It was political reasons, what was going on in the world, right, that caused them to radically depart from most everything that came before.
Mm.
And I think that's sometimes a little bit lost. You know, we seem to have divorced architecture from a lot of what goes on in society and politics. And these were obviously political. These were like punk rockers of their time. You know, it was something that had never, I mean, the image of the Rietveld with its back to all the buildings that had been built
right
for 100 years before it is a pretty radical statement.
Right.
I mean, people must have thought the world was going crazy. So I just wonder if you could talk a little bit about that, because I think that's something that's a little bit lost to students and myself sometimes.
Yeah, right. Yes, it's not so easy to get at it, I don't think. I mean, I think that, you know, there is, you know, what we inherit, I mean, part of the virtues, if there are virtues, of this game is that the you know, otherwise sort of rather difficult divorce between the work of the studio and the work of people who teach, I don't know what, history theory or something of that sort, and is kind of very categorically different, you know. So part of the game, I think, is to try and bridge that gap, you know. It's not really answering, I know it's not really answering the question you made, but there is that, and in that you know process, the effort anyway is directed towards trying to establish the traditions plural of the new, you know, as we receive it from this period of history, and you could extend it, of course, and the book does extend it to recent works. I mean, the Centre Pompidou is in the book, and the Norman Foster Cultural Center in Aix-en-Provence is in the book, etc. You know, and also at the end, two stadia, one by Renzo Piano and one by Bonelli Rius, are compared. You know, that also brings up another issue, which is in fact comparing those two buildings a little problematic because the size of the stadia are very different. You know, so it's not the happiest of comparisons in the book, and you know, so, and then that brings up another issue, which is, you know, what buildings do you choose to analyze? What, I mean, why can't one do this with any, you know, theoretically, why could you not do this with any building, you know, and which is and is not related to your question, you know, because I mean, it's not, unless the building has a kind of density and intentionality, which is layered and rich, you know, it's almost not worth analyzing the building, you know. Although you could say that there's an a priori sort of subjective judgment involved as to whether the tutor thinks that this building A is sufficiently dense to compare to this building B, you know, that kind of problematic, uncomfortable aspect of the whole game, you know. It's kind of loaded. You can say the dice are loaded, you know, they are. And that's still not answering your question, because, but I can only really get at it by saying, you know, that I think that ultimately the tradition of the new is a very complex tradition. I mean, some of that is hinted at in the Le Corbusier map, where he is. I mean, that's what makes him absolutely kind of a magus, really, in the whole scene, because of the complexity of his mind and imagination. You know, to get involved with this idea of a map of Europe, in which there are different levels of cultural production coexisting at the same time. You know, and I've never found out exactly, but I think it's Hoffman's style. Or maybe it's loose. Somebody says, you know, men live at the same time in different periods of history, and that's what, you know, that is about in a way. You know, this fact that he recognizes this different.
Wait, can you say that again?
Men live at the same time in different periods of history. Mm-hmm. You know, and it's a beautiful aphorism, I think. And yeah, I mean, of course, less and less is that the case because of the, for obvious reasons, for, you know. So it's not easy to answer your question in a straightforward way. I just think that, you know, the fact that they, well, okay, that appears that it came out of outer space, you know, you can say. But if you look at Aalto's Villa Maria, you know, it's maybe not so foreign, you know. It's using, anyway, it's using traditional material, you know, which or material in a traditional way, mostly, combined with other material, of course. You know, but so there's, you know, therefore the legacy is very complex. And what I suppose I believe is that students should be made aware of the complexity of the legacy. And fashion tends to short circuit all of that, so that one does something because it goes along with a certain kind of imagery which is current at the moment, and there's no reflection on something that goes deeper, you know, in terms of the predicament of the whole game. You know, you can say that in some sense architecture is anachronistic. You know, it's an anachronistic given the domination of technoscience and globalized consumerism, for example. You know, architecture is a strange field. Yeah. Yes.
Behan? Go
ahead. Yeah.
Okay.
Observation. Any questions? Well, the observation is really for mostly our students when Kenneth, kind of in his missive, pointed at something, which is, he said, one does not go through the game of looking at photographs. Of course, plans and the drawings are important. I think that we go through that, a lot of us, with our students, and that when we ask them to look at a building or to analyze it, that they look at a lot of photographs, and oftentimes they don't come up with the information and the concept that's really in the thoughts of the architect. I think so. That's a very important point, even though Ken kind of said it in a very quick way, and I think that's very important for us. The question I have is the following. I know that from being one of your students and also following up what's happening, you often have, I mean, you almost always have these projects when they're being analyzed, you have students build models of them. Yet in this book, none of the model photographs idea is included.
Yeah.
Can you please articulate that about that?
You know, there is an exhibition of models that are kind of left over from teaching by me at different times. And most of the models, the exhibition will open tomorrow in Colombia. It's a funny exhibition. But anyway, I'm happy about the fact that there are some models there that were made in the course that has the title Studies in Tectonic Culture, and they were made as models that were intended to, they made, I mean, the The idea is to make a didactic model which reveal, and not a schematic model, nor a realistic model, but a didactic model that reveals the conceptual poetic of construction that's inherent to the work, you know. There's some of those models, but there is one model that's also in the exhibition because the dean wanted to have whatever model she could lay her hands on. A model of the Riedbach Schroeder house, you know, which has been sitting around in Columbia forever. And obviously, I asked some student, or some students made that, I can't remember anymore, that model as part of a sort of, I don't know, fulfilling a general history course. And it's quite a nice model. But it hasn't. But it's completely different from the other models that are being shown in the space, in that it's not really to do with this question of trying to make a didactic model which reveals a certain poetic based on the way the work is constructed. Although it does show, it does give some information about that as a model. I mean, but. Yes, I mean, why aren't there any models? Well, I mean, any models that, well, there is actually a model that, because when I came to the Le Corbusier Pavillon de Tom Nouveau, which I used one of those models, which is a model of the structure of the Pavillon de Tom Nouveau, as a kind of exemplifying the reality of that pavilion at the time that it was made, you know. Of course, it doesn't exist anymore, didn't almost immediately after the exhibition closed. I don't know how to answer the question, really. I tried to use documentary material which was available and which was produced at the time in relation to the thing under consideration. And, of course, laid on top of that is an analysis of plans, which are drawings made by students, you know, as part of the overall exercise. Which is not made at the time that the buildings were made, but there aren't models, it's true. I'm not sure what to do with the models in that particular exercise, actually. I know what I was trying to do with the models for the tectonic thing. You alluded to something which I have recently had to come to terms with, which is that Thames and Hudson, the publisher of Modern Architectural History, wants to expand it to include the non-Eurocentric world. Mm. And recently I've become very interested in architects in Bangladesh, you know, that are very sophisticated architects. I mean, not so many, but enough to make one take notice, you know. And it's a place that you'd, it's a very difficult place. It's a place that depends on the monsoon and suffers from the monsoon and from continual flooding, of course, you know. And it's also, of course, you know, it suffers from the usual thing of a capital city, which is absolutely impossible, you know, because of the number of people in it, the number of automobiles and so on. But it's still, you know, it's really part of, it is remarkable the level of work that's being done by, of course, for a certain class, you know, no escaping it, and mostly, and also by certain architects that also belong to this class, you know. That also can't be escaped either, because clearly it's, you know, it's a profession that is always anchored in, I mean, there are, in the historic history, of course, there are moments like this figure that I mentioned, Shuta Lehotsky, you know, who comes from a bourgeois background but works her entire life for socialist state, and you know, but in the main, of course, it is, you know, it's a class, the profession is a class, and it works for a certain class, you know. It's inescapable, you know, reality, I think. With these exceptions that have occurred at different times, you know, with socialist governments or with welfare state governments. But we're rather removed from that, I think.
Mm-hmm. Judy, go ahead.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I
mean, that's not like
you
at all.
How am I surprised, right?
Well, no, I'm super, super intrigued with the complexity of the Corbusier map.
Oh, yeah.
And the introduction of, the folklore.
Yeah.
The folklore is a most curious situation because the folklore means, if I understand what you're using it as, the things that are brought into these modern worlds,
yeah, right.
By the owner, let's say? Or does Corbusier presume that these buildings are built to display, quote-unquote, the folklore? Because, for instance, at the Villa Garche, that amazing image of the interior of this modern machine with all of that heavy wood, Spanish-like furniture, seems in contradiction.
In the Maison Cook, you mean?
Talking about Maison.
And also Garche when they occupied.
Yeah, yes. And I'm just wondering, did Corbusier? Is this in his complex mind an intentional thing that he wanted to see the introduction of folklore?
Yeah, well, I think it connects to Adolf Loos. I think that it was a Loosian idea, you know, Loosian kind of ethical idea that against the idea of the total work of art, you know. And therefore, you know, his use of the Thonne chair and industrial light fittings and glassware, you know, industrially produced, et cetera, as it appears, there's this great shot inside the dining room of La Roche, you know, which shows both the purist painting and then on the high up there is a goldfish bowl and there's a kind of cabinet with rolling shutters and an industrial lamp and B12 or B14, whatever, this Thonne armchair, you know. So he is selecting those industrially produced pieces, which his clients don't do, but he's also selecting them, you know, in a way to break, well, it's all very paradoxical in a way, because it's like breaking the total work of art thing and also returning, you know, it's sort of returning to it, this idea of equipment, you know, which he and all of it preoccupies him against the 1935 L'Exposition des Arts Décoratifs. You know. And two things happen, you know, in 1929, he finishes the Villa Savoye, and in that sense, that's the last purist villa. That's also a fact that when the neo-Corbusian discourse starts in the States, you know, the five architects and et cetera, you know, don't follow him because, you know, he breaks decisively his position. You know, he abandons the purism. And the Villa Errasuris is, you know, using vernacular, you know, undressed timber, rubble stone walling, et cetera, et cetera. You know. And so his whole sort of discourse becomes more complicated. But I think when, you know, when you rightly pointed out, when the Stein family move into Garche, they have this heavy furniture and they do have oriental carpets, but he, you know, they just put in their stuff, you know. And I think, you know, at that moment, he has this kind of Loosian idea that people should just be free to put in what the hell they want, you know. And then, you know, at some point he breaks from the purist position and he, you know, it's a fundamental change. I mean, one of the most beautiful buildings, I think, made along these lines is the 1935 Weekend House in Saint-Cloud, where, you know, he combines rubble stone walling, earth, shell concrete vaults, white painted brickwork, plywood ceilings, and plate glass and steel frames and glass bricks. They're all combined in the... So he's mixing now, you know, archaic, European, rubble stone, European masonry technique with, shell concrete, with plate glass, steel frame. He's putting it all together, in this kind of little mythic house, which no longer exists, unfortunately. But he's a subtle old monster, no doubt about it.
Yes, back there.
Hi. I wrote my question down. So based on the book, Modern Architecture is Analyzed, within this trichotomy of the classic, the vernacular, and the technological, I'm curious to know, how did you decide on these three keywords? And also, is it appropriate to analyze contemporary and postmodern, post-postmodern architecture within that framework, within that trinity?
Great question.
Yeah, it's a good question, yes. I don't know how to answer it. I mean, I used it because he uses it, first of all.
Who's he?
Corbusier.
I see.
In the map, And because he's aware of it, because you can see from the detailing that there is this going on in his brain, the culture in the sense of humanist, classical, harmonic ideas going back to the Greek, I suppose, but also going, let's say for that matter, to the vernacular architecture of the Mediterranean, vaulted vernacular architecture of the Mediterranean. And and vernacular, there's certain still a validity, I think, but it's clear that vernacular and technology, or let's put it this way, archaic, relatively speaking, archaic ways of building, and very sophisticated ways of building which are dependent upon industrial production and industrial methods coexist and have coexisted for a long time and still, I think, basically coexist. And so they are there as an availability, really, something that is kind of available, depending, of course, on other factors that impinge on the real situation. But you can say vernacular is more problematic, and probably you have to confess that sort of vernacular in the pure sense of vernacular no longer exists, that you don't have a kind of rooted instinctual vernacular. There are obviously, isolated parts of the world where the vernacular still exists, under enormous pressure. And that pressure was already, he was already aware of this pressure in 1925, when in the L'Art Décoratif d'aujourd'hui, Decorative Arts Today, he remarks on the fact that cheap tin production from Western countries is penetrating into the Balkans and destroying the basic vernacular ceramic culture of the Balkans. This is in the early part of the 20s. He's very aware that is what is going on, So the vernacular in that sense is even more and more, it's more and more eroded in a way,
We have time for one more question. Yes. Go ahead. Yeah.
So I'm just curious, what was your... I'm just curious, what was your exact move after you graduated from your education? And fast forwarding to today's day and age, what kind of advice would you tell the next generation of architects?
Great question. The question.
Yeah. Actually, I have a student who just went to Mexico City I think it's the best thing that ever happened to him, you know. Judging from a recent letter I received, I mean, it's absolutely extraordinary. He's been there about 3 weeks. He worked on a Dada exhibition that was put up in the Louis Barragan house, you know. Very simple exhibition, but with beautiful kind of quasi-surrealist furniture pieces and this Dada exhibition around the walls. And he's working for a Mexican woman architect. And there is a kind of a moment, I think, is a lot of energy in Mexico City with a lot of young people that have, you know, have clients. And it's a good moment, you know. And so there is this possibility of making a break for it, you know. I mean, you know, but also from a point of view of experience, because if, you know, you're relatively young, as he is, and you know, probably you, et cetera, you know, it's a moment in your life where you could go somewhere where there is more, a different kind of energy. You know, and in my case, I did crazy things. Like when I graduated, I went to the British Army because I was still conscription. That was a very stupid thing to do. I really wish I'd gone to France, forgot about it, gone illegally to France and stayed in France and forget about it. You know, but I think it would have been much better for my own development to have made that move than to spend 2 years in the stupid British Army. You know. And when I got out of that, I went to Israel, and the one virtue of going to Israel was that the technology at that time was very very simple, concrete block, concrete frame, you know, climatic conditions do not, you know, not a lot of problem with water penetration and rain. You know, I found that incredibly liberating, and it gave me, I got a lot out of 1 year in that country, you know. I don't know, you know, there's no recipe.
So you're saying travel?
Well, I think it's good to do that, yes. You know, particularly once you have responsibilities, you're unlikely to do that, you know, so to speak. And personal responsibilities, I mean. Mm-hmm. Yeah, is that it? We've done it?
Okay. Thank you so much, Ken.